Mitch McConnell's role in the January 6 PSYOP.
Mr. Reagan.
It has been said by many that Mitch McConnell is a rhino. But why do people say this? Well, different people have different reasons, but my reason is January 6th. On January 6th, Mitch McConnell betrayed Donald Trump. He betrayed the Trump supporters who were there at the Capitol on that day, and he betrayed America. As most of you know, on January 6th, both the Senate and the House had to meet to confirm the electoral votes that had been cast for Joe Biden. Many Republicans had pledged to, at these confirmation proceedings, demand that an audit commission be formed in order to investigate election irregularities, right? Many of us believe that there was fraud. Many of us believe that the election was rigged. And so many Republicans said, let's demand an audit commission. And, you know, if there were no audit, then Ted Cruz and Ron Johnson, they had pledged that they were going to reject the Electoral College results. And look, this would have provided a platform from which Republicans could have been able to present the mountain of evidence of election fraud in 2020. And the nation would have heard about all this stuff, and they could have then made an informed decision as to the validity of Trump's claims of election rigging. Now, naturally, Nancy Pelosi and the Democrats did not want this. But a perhaps less obvious objector was Mitch McConnell. And Mitch McConnell was a very vocal objector to this demand for an audit. Now, why the heck would Mitch McConnell be against the presentation of evidence of election fraud? Why would he be against delaying the confirmation of electors? I will get to that in one moment. First, of course, I have to sell you something. All right, you know those ads for buying prepper food kits in case disaster strikes? Well, this is one of those ads. But I think the ad copy that the company gave me, I actually think it's pretty good. It's compelling. Listen to this. They wrote, "You won't believe it, but Gen Z is probably more prepared than you are. Recent research reveals a whopping 40% of Gen Z is prepared for the worst. That's twice what Gen X is doing. Shocked? Well, Gen Z knows that something big is coming." And look, maybe not. Maybe nothing big is coming. Maybe everything is going to be just fine. But a lot of us are pretty concerned about the 2024 election, and you know that it is possible that everything is not going to be just fine. I'm preparing for the worst in ways that you would not believe. Actually, I'm doing way more than buying food kits. But if you have a family, the time to do something about a potential disaster in America really is right now. So go to my affiliate link, preparewithmrreagan.com, and there you will find a really good offer, actually. This is really unusual for my Patriot Supply. It's a one-year food kit, a food kit large enough to last you one whole year, and they're going to give you $700 off. So this is just under $2,000. But then basically you are set. You are good to go. All right, let me read the rest of this copy here. My Patriot Supply has helped millions of Americans prepare for emergencies. They're ready to help you too. Sealed inside rugged four-layer packaging, their delicious meals last up to 25 years in storage and provide over 2,000 calories a day. That's over 2,000 calories a day for over a year at a special price of under $2,000. This rare emergency food kit deal ends this week and you won't see it again. And look, if you're not interested in this, don't worry about it. But if you do want this kind of thing, I think now is actually a really good time to get it. So go to preparewithmrreagan.com. Free shipping is included. Preparewithmrreagan.com. All right, now for the record, I stole much of this story from Julie Kelly, who brilliantly reported on this in 2022. But I feel that nobody has really paid attention to this story, which is insane to me because it explains a lot of what happened on January 6th. And I think a lot of people still have questions about that day and about how things were set up. All right, so Mitch McConnell, who as a top Republican, you would think would absolutely want claims of election fraud looked into, who you think would want to be absolutely sure that the Democrats won before conceding, this guy suddenly started fighting against Republicans. This is what he said to the Senate on January 6th about the confirmation vote while the protesters were gathered outside the Capitol on that day.
"We're debating a step that has never been taken in American history. Whether Congress should overrule the voters and overturn a presidential election. I've served 36 years in the Senate. This will be the most important vote I've ever cast. President Trump claims the election was stolen. The assertions range from specific local allegations to constitutional arguments to sweeping conspiracy theories. Every election, we know, features some illegality, but my colleagues, nothing before us proves illegality anywhere near the massive scale that would have tipped the entire election. The voters, the courts, and the states have all spoken. If we overrule them, it would damage our republic forever. This election actually was not unusually close. The Electoral College margin is almost identical to what it was in 2016. Congress will either override the voters, overrule them, the voters, the states, and the courts for the first time ever, or honor the people's decision. It would be unfair and wrong to disenfranchise American voters and overrule the courts and the states on this extraordinarily thin basis. And I will not pretend such a vote would be a harmless protest gesture while relying on others to do the right thing. I will vote to respect the people's decision and defend our system of government as we know it.
That is not the speech of a man who wants to get to the truth. That is the speech of a man who wants everybody to just step in line and do what they're told. In 2021, the author Jonathan Barn interviewed Mitch McConnell for his book, This Will Not Pass, and Mitch McConnell's responses were truly bizarre. About January 6, McConnell said, "I feel exhilarated by the fact that Trump finally totally discredited himself." He said that Trump, quote, "put a gun to his head and pulled the trigger." He then claimed, apparently referring to Trump supporters from what I understand, he claimed that he'd, quote, "crushed the sons of bitches" and vowed to do the same in 2022. And indeed, McConnell sabotaged Republican efforts in 2022 with talk of a nationwide abortion ban, which galvanized Democrats. So, okay, Mitch McConnell is a deep state stooge. We all know that already. But here's the interesting thing about January 6th. McConnell, Pelosi, and Muriel Bowser, I wonder if she's related to the Mario Brothers villain. Must be. These three people, they had the power to call in the National Guard, but they didn't. Not only did they neglect to do this before the protest, in spite of warnings from a variety of sources, accurate or not, that violence was planned, but even during the so-called insurrection, when senators and congressmen claimed that they were running for their lives, they still failed to do this. And Trump's people actually said, "Do you want National Guard troops? We will give you National Guard troops." And Nancy Pelosi, Mitch McConnell, Muriel Bowser, these people were just like, "Eh, we're good. They later, of course, claimed that they were afraid for their lives, but they were just like, "Nah, we don't need the National Guard" at the time. Okay, there's something's off there, obviously. It's almost like they wanted the protest to get out of hand. But why? Why would they want this? Well, a blog called The Conservative Treehouse, they've put the pieces of the puzzle together. And their conclusions are, I think, pretty spot on. Let me read directly from the blog here. Now, they asked a series of questions about January 6th relating to Mitch McConnell. And remember McConnell's speech? He did not want Congress to delay the certification of electoral votes. So this is going to be from the blog here. Question 1. How do you prevent Congress from delaying the certification of state electoral votes? Answer. It requires a crisis that creates an emergency that invokes special House rules. So if you have the normal certification process, you can, of course, demand this audit. You can, of course, not certify the electoral votes. You can have all these kind of issues. Apparently, during an emergency session, a lot of these rules of conduct and stuff, they go out the window and you just have like this straight vote. There's no debate. There's no argument. That, you know, these emergency rules are a little bit different. So they continue here. Just moments, literally 3 minutes before two representatives issued a vote for motions to suspend the certification, the House members were informed by Capitol Police and other agents that a protest was about to breach the chambers. It was at this time that key people, Pelosi, Pence, Schumer, McConnell, can be seen walked out and escorted from the chamber. This effectively halted the entire chamber process. Question 2. Why was it necessary to halt the chamber process? Answer, the crisis was created to eliminate the motion challenges to halt the certification and to begin voting to look into voting irregularities and fraud. So the theory that these guys have on this blog here is that the crisis was created to eliminate the motion challenges to look into election fraud, right? To audit the entire election, essentially. Question three, what was so important to refuse this motion and subsequent votes to suspend the electoral certification? Answer, it was important to remove that process entirely and continue the fraud and certify the fraud with no detractors on record. This effectively gives no standing for a Supreme Court ruling appeal. If those two motions, even if just one had successfully been voted, even if the motions were denied in vote, this gives those who presented them with standing for a constitutional legal argument before the Supreme Court. I don't really know about this stuff. I'm not a lawyer, but apparently, if they had been able to successfully just present those motions in Congress, then they would have had standing for a constitutional legal argument before the Supreme Court. So look, I don't know if this is right or not. I'm like I said, I'm not a lawyer, but I'm inclined to believe them. Any constitutional scholars out there, you may want to weigh in the comment section below. Question four, could this have been done some other way other than creating a crisis slash protest? Answer, unlikely. In order to prevent those two motions requires that the Speaker of the House, minority leaders, and the President of the Congress, which is the Vice President of the United States, Mike Pence, to not be present in the chambers. Once the Capitol Police and other law enforcement agents inform the Speaker and these three other individuals, Pelosi unilaterally, under emergency rules, suspended the business of Congress. This protest was necessary. The crisis was created because there was no other way to suspend the business of certification unilaterally. Creating a crisis invokes emergency procedures. No other circumstances other than war or mass simultaneous explosive diarrhea could have created such a unilateral speaker-delivered suspension of the certification. Basically, what these guys are saying is that if this was the plan to stop these people from delaying the vote, these Republicans, then really they needed something this extreme, right? Like an insurrection to be able to stop it. So this is why they think that this was planned. I'm not sure that this is why this was planned, but I think it's possible that this plan for like this psyop, for this, you know, agitating the crowd and trying to create the illusion of an insurrection, this argument could be what convinced Mitch McConnell to jump on board. Because from what they're saying, I am totally convinced that Mitch McConnell was in on the whole thing. Before this, I wasn't sure. I didn't really know much about what Mitch McConnell's role would have been in this. I didn't really understand what his motivation would have been. But it's very obvious that he did not want this vote delayed. He talked about it in his speech. So we know that he really didn't want this delay. So if he really didn't want it bad enough, it could have been motivation for him to jump on board to this insurrection illusion psyop. Question five, why did the motions, once the Speaker reconvened Congress, move forward back again to the floor votes? Why were members disallowed even to consider putting forward any motions to the floor when the chamber business was reopened? Answer, the Speaker initiated the new sessions under special emergency rules, as I said before. These rules make it clear that the only purpose of the new session was to expedite the certification and dismiss all prior regular session procedural rules. This is why those two motions to table votes in order to consider a debate and to pause the certification of state vote electors never happened later that evening when the House business was reconvened. So it's all about, you know, the emergency session. The emergency session, I guess, streamlines the process. And so you can't object. You can't call for an audit. You can't do anything. You just have to basically just certify. That's it. And apparently these Republicans were convinced to go along with this, or I don't know if they had a choice. You know, Pelosi just unilaterally made these choices and Republicans were just stuck, you know. Question six, other than new rules, emergency rules, what other peculiar things occurred when the Speaker reconvened? Answer, members were allowed to vote in proxy, remotely, not being present. You can use your imagination about what conditions were placed on all members during this time to prevent anyone from getting out of line, right? So this is what I'm talking about. At this point, who knows who was talking to them? You know, who knows what they were told? Who knows what pressures were placed on them to just streamline the process and certify the electors and not, you know, cause any kind of a fuss? Essentially, what this guy's saying is it's possible that, you know, senators and congressmen were manipulated at this point privately, either bribed or more likely threatened. They also write here, also clearly, it was at this new session that VP Pence, president of the Congress, would have had no ability to even consider pausing the electoral certification because there were no motions of disagreement on the matter. So in a technical legal claim, he is correct that he had no constitutional authority to address any issues of fraud or doubts about the election irregularities, but this completely dismisses the fact that Congress created rules in this crisis slash emergency that never allowed them to be floored. All right, so this is how this guy sums up his whole case here. He says, this was a coup. It was a very organized and carefully planned coup. VP Pence, without a doubt, as well as most members of the House, were quite aware of how the certification was going to be managed. It would require new rules to prevent the debate clause from occurring. So this guy thinks even Mike Pence was in on this. These new rules that only an emergency crisis could create. So they created an emergency. And you know what? I think this guy is right. All of this makes a lot of sense. I have always believed that the January 6th PSYOP was devised as a way to demonize Trump and to demonize Trump supporters. But primarily, I have always believed that it was intended as a way to stop Trump from ever running for president again. You know, he was involved in an insurrection. The Constitution says he can't run for president again. Like, this is why they kept using the word insurrection. And look, I still believe that all of those things were true. I think they had multiple motivations for this PSYOP. However, this breakdown of the rules of Congress provides a more immediate motivation for Pelosi and McConnell. It provides the motivation I didn't know about to have called this emergency session. So yeah, I do think that this is right. I think that this so-called insurrection, it solved a lot of problems for Pelosi and McConnell and the rest of the deep state. And this is why it is so critical that we get Donald Trump back in the White House. We have to cut out the rotten cancer in Washington, D.C. that is the corrupt deep state. All right, well, that's it for me. Let me know what you guys think in the comment section below. And remember, it's not that the liberal friends are ignorant. It's just they know so much that is not so. Good night.
We're at war with the most dangerous enemy that has ever faced mankind in his long climb from the swamp to the stars. And it's been said if we lose that war, and in so doing lose this way of freedom of ours, history will record with the greatest astonishment that those who had the most to lose did the least to prevent its happening. If we lose freedom here, there's no place to escape to. This is the last stand on earth.